Good morning. He is risen. What a wonderful reality, isn't it? What we celebrate today is the focus of the Christian faith. What makes Christianity unique is that our founder, if you will, does not lie in a tomb. He sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven, where he ever lives to make intercession for us. We serve a risen, living Savior, and that's what Easter is about. And we welcome you. Thank you for coming. My name is Sid. I'm the, what do you call it, transitional pastor, interim whatever, the part-time dude. So, and we're glad you're here this morning to worship with us, and we are looking forward to a time to celebrate our Lord and each other. A few announcements. To find the order of worship with today's music, go to the fpcmmonrovia.org homepage and click on the three little lines in the upper left-hand corner. Click on worship service, then Sunday worship order. Okay, and that will get you on your phone or your other device, or if you have it implanted in your head or something. So that should work. And then a message from Team Open Up, your COVID conscious experts. We do have folks who keep pretty close track of what's happening. And they say, please keep your masks on even if you are fully vaccinated. Make sure they don't slip. And when you're talking or they slip, especially while singing. When exiting the sanctuary, please exit to the sides and go back. Now, I'm going to announce this again at the end of the service, but there's about a 50% chance I will forget. The leakage factor increases with age, and I've never been a detail person. I live by the 50-50-90 rule. You're familiar with the 50-50-90 rule? There's a 50% chance of doing it right or wrong. There's a 90% chance I'll do it wrong. So there's about a 90% chance I will forget to announce it again, but I will try. So, okay, and what I'm doing right now is emphasizing and re-emphasizing. Please exit to the sides. You may run into an angry person back there in the middle telling you. Okay, that's a joke, bad one. Wednesday night, it's a wonderful service. It's called Prayer on the Pavement. We meet outside. It's a time of worship and singing and fellowship together on our patio. That's at 7 o'clock on Wednesday evening out here in the on our wonderful patio. Oh, 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock. See, like I said. 6 o'clock. Okay, thank you. Are there other announcements that I should have? Okay. Without further ado, let us worship our Lord. Let me open us with prayer. Our Father, we are grateful for this privilege of being here in this place. Thank you that we can be inside and be together. We ask you, our Father, to let us be aware of your presence. We don't invite you. We don't ask you to be here. This is your house. You have invited us. We are your guests. And I pray that we will be fully aware of what a privilege it is to be in a place, in a country, in a culture where worshiping you is a good thing. It's an accepted thing. So please accept our expressions of love, our expressions of worship this morning. In Jesus' holy name we pray.
Good morning. Will you stand if you are able and join us in singing our first hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Now I'll tell you, sing really quietly under your masks, okay? But feel free to express yourselves.
Thank you.
can't see the, we have a lot of paraphernalia up here, so you may not be able to see the flowers, but there's some beautiful flowers. So if you exit around the outside, you can come up front after the service and see the beautiful flowers. We appreciate those who have decorated our sanctuary. It's very nice. Our Unison reading this morning is taken from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 7. It's on the order of service if you have it on your phone. If you happen to bring a Bible, it's the New American Standard 2011 translation. If you have another one, feel free to read along, and if it's out of sync a little bit here and there, don't worry about it. Let's stand in honor of God's word as we read it. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, 'The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.'" May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
We're going to sing a song together. This is called Revelation Song. I'm so excited to be able to worship our Lord and Savior, our risen King today, our worthy Lamb. Holy, holy is he. Now, I know you just sat down, but if you'd like to stand and worship, you are welcome to. We're going to sing this song, "Worthy is the Lamb Who Was Slain." Let's pray. God, thank you for being our risen King, holier than we can know. And most importantly, because of what you did on the cross and that you've risen and conquered death, that you are making us more holy with you. Lord, we praise you.
Was slain. Oh. Good morning. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, what a gift you have given us today. Lord, we just pray for every person who has turned from you, who is lost, who is broken, who doesn't know their way, Lord, that you can touch them and reach them, Lord, that they know that you are with them and they are not lost, that you have them in your hands, Lord. Lord, we pray for every person that is hurting from losing family and friends that aren't with us any longer. Lord, we just ask you to comfort them and just keep them close and let them know that their lost loved ones are with you, Lord. Lord, we pray for every person that is ill, that is suffering from any kind of sickness, Lord, that you heal them, Lord, that your will be done with them, Lord, that you give them the doctors and the medical staff to take care of whatever your will is, Lord. Lord, we just ask that you be with every person here. Lord, we just are so thankful that we have such loving and caring members and friends of our church, Lord, and we just ask you to watch over them and comfort them. Lord, we ask for your hand in our pastoral nominating committee as you bring to us the right pastor for our church, Lord, whoever that is, that they bless our church, that they have your will in their hearts, that they come to this church and they make a presence in our community, in our church members and family, Lord. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Sid as he watches over us during our time of transition, as he leads us, as he mentors and guides us, Lord. We thank you for all of the blessings that you give to us, and we are just so thankful for you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Today, we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, who began this 2 days before with his death, when he paid the price of sin once and for all, for all sin, forever. And with his death, with his resurrection, he conquered death and gave to us the incomparable gift, not only of eternal life, but eternal life free from slavery to sin. What an awesome God to give himself for something that we could no longer accomplish or never accomplish on our own. The psalmist tells us that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And now is the time when we can give with a joyful heart and a sense of awe, return to God a small portion of the many blessings he has showered upon us. Because of COVID restrictions, we will not pass a plate, but there are many ways to give as you feel moved. Outside the main door with which you entered the sanctuary is a box for collection. You can also mail any offering to the church. And at the Myrtle entrance to the office, there's a mail slot in the door, which is a perfectly safe place to leave a contribution. And finally, many of you have found the convenience of the Tithely app on your phone. Thank you.
Thank you.
are so grateful for the abundance of mercy and grace with which you have blessed us. Please accept these humble gifts in the spirit in which they are offered, and may they give you glory and honor to you, to your Son, and to your Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, if you're able, please rise and joyfully sing the doxology.
Sing it quietly under your breath.
There are many reasons why the resurrection is a crucial reality of the Christian faith. But one of the reasons that makes most sense to me is, so what? In any sermon, there are three questions we must answer. First, is it clear? Do people understand what in the world we're talking about? Second, is it true? If people understand our point, do they believe it? And then the third question, so what? What difference does it make? Well, the passage we look at this morning, I believe, is one of the premier Christian Bible passages. When we attempt to answer the question, how should we live? And how can we live that way? And the key to not only the Christian doctrine and the church historical reality, but to the day-to-day, moment-to-moment life that we attempt to live as Christians. We are called to live holy lives. Be holy as I am holy. You shall be my witnesses. I give you a new commandment that you love one another. Love your enemies. Many of these realities that we read about, we hear about in church, we study in our Bible studies, take on a different complexion when we're living life day to day in the world. The answer to the question, how can I possibly live this way? How can I possibly come back to church and worship God if I have failed Him? How can I pray when I don't live the life that Jesus asked me to live? Is there hope? Is there restoration for me as I struggle with life, with being the kind of person that the Bible tells me I should be? Our passage is Hebrews chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. If you have your Bible, again, or if it's on your app, follow along. But here's what the writer of Hebrews said to his readers and to us today as his readers. The Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. He penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and he judges the thoughts and attitudes of our heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from his sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account, or literally to him, the Logos, the Word. Therefore, Since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses. We have a high priest who has been tested in every way just as we are, yet he never sinned. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Now, if you were following along, you may have noticed that there were a couple of places where I didn't read the text as it's translated here. That's because a number of years ago, I was preaching through the book of Hebrews in a series. Whenever I do a book series, I first study the whole book so that each passage I can fit into the context so that it contributes to the theme and the driving point of that whole book, and it fits in its context. And as I was studying the book of Hebrews, I came to this passage, which has traditionally been translated, and if you read your commentaries, as a reference to the Bible. The Word of God is generally understood as a reference to the Bible. And as I read that, I said, it cannot mean the Bible. This is a reference to Jesus. Even though I was taught in seminary, and three seminary professors were in the congregation when I was preaching that morning, I didn't want to preach what I believed, but I did. And all three seminary professors came to me after, and they said, I never saw that passage that way before, but I believe you're right. I presented this thesis to three of my colleagues when I was on the seminary faculty, New Testament scholars, PhDs in Greek and New Testament, with a long list, a long discussion of why I believe that this is a reference to Jesus. And all three of them said, I agree. So the first question, is it clear? Well, the reason I'm taking a moment on this is I believe it is clear that this passage is a reference to our high priest, Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Second question, is it true? Why do you believe that when so many of the commentaries say it's a reference to the Bible? Well, of the long list, I'm not going to bore you to death. You'll be sleeping by 3 o'clock this afternoon if I go through that whole rendition. Let me give you three. First, lexically, the word logos says the logos of God is alive, or literally living. Alive is the logos of God. Can the word logos refer to Jesus? Well, John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the logos, and the logos was with God, and the logos was God. And John 14 says, and the logos became flesh and dwelt among us. Obviously a reference to Jesus. Then in 1 John chapter 1, John was saying what we have seen, that which was from the beginning, what we have seen, what we have seen, heard, what we have touched with our hands, we proclaim to you the Logos of God. And in Revelation 19, where John is talking about the return of Christ, the great second coming of Christ, John says, and his name is the Logos of God. So yes, lexically it fits. Second, contextually, how does this passage fit into the book of Hebrews? Well, the book of Hebrews opens with these words. Long ago, God spoke to our fathers through the prophets in many portions and in many ways. In these last days, he has spoken to us in his Son. God's message, God's logos, God's word to us today is not like it was in the olden days, many portions in many ways. God has spoken to us in his Son. And then all the way through, we come to the end of the book of Hebrews, to chapter 13, we have this doxology that ends with these words, now may the God of peace who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep. Equip you with everything for doing good, doing his will. May he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ. So he began with Jesus Christ, he ended with Jesus Christ. And throughout this book, there's this driving, pounding argument to help these Hebrew Christians who had grown up with Judaism, who had a religion from God. And that's how the writer began. God who spoke to our fathers through the prophets in many portions and in many ways. The Old Testament scriptures are from God. He spoke to our fathers. But he spoke again. And this time he spoke to us in his Son, Jesus Christ. And then throughout the book, he's saying, why would you go back to God's previous message when this message is so superior? When this message is about the only begotten Son of God. So the argument he's making is to show that Jesus Christ, when God spoke again through him, is a superior revelation. Superior to what the angel spoke, Hebrews chapter 2. Superior to what Moses spoke, Hebrews chapter 3. So while in this whole argument, this whole book about Jesus and about Jesus' superiority, why would the writer stop and just put in one verse and say, you know, man, I haven't written anything about the Bible yet. I'm just going to put one verse about the Bible, and then I'm going to go back to my idea and start talking about Jesus again. It makes no sense. So theologically, to say this is that a living and active is the Bible doesn't make sense. Now, I respect the Bible. I spent my whole adult life studying it. Have 2 degrees in biblical studies. I've taught it in seminary, and I've taught it. It's my whole professional life. My whole spiritual life is based on what this book says. So I'm not putting down the Bible. I'm just saying this verse doesn't talk about the Bible. The Bible is not alive. But Jesus is. And what this passage says is literally alive is God's logos and active. So is it true that this passage is about Jesus? I plead with you to read it that way. Because we lose one of the most crucial passages about what it means for you and me on a day-to-day basis to be Christian if we lose this passage. What he says is the Logos of God is alive. And he's active. He's participating. And he used the image like a two-edged sword because that was the sharpest thing available for him to reference. Today we would say like a laser. He pierces to our innermost being. And then he uses this imagery. He separates between soul and spirit, between joints and marrow. And he discerns between our thoughts and intentions of our heart. And if you stop and think about those things, the soul and the spirit refer to the living part of us as opposed to the physical part of us. And sometimes it's hard to distinguish when the biblical writers use soul and spirit. It's a pretty complicated thing. But the writer is saying Jesus goes to the center, dividing that which we find difficult to divide, between the joints and marrow. Kind of hard for people in that day to understand the physical makeup of the human being, so that most pretty tightly connected thing, our bones and our joints and our marrow. And he's able to discern the thoughts and intentions between the thoughts. What intention did you ever have that wasn't a thought? So all he's saying there is Jesus goes to the very center of our being. He isolates and understands things that we don't understand. What he's saying is Jesus knows you better than you know yourself. Sharper than any double-edged sword, like a laser, he penetrates to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and judges the thoughts and intentions of our heart. So he doesn't just see them. He judges them. There's a good thought. There's a brilliant idea. What are you thinking? The good ones and the bad ones. I know most of you probably never have bad ones, but periodically I do. It says, what I'm thinking, not only my thoughts, but my intentions, my motives. The thoughts, motives, attitudes of the heart. And then he goes further. If you're not already a little bit nervous about this, nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered, naked, laid bare to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Whew. So that's saying every thought, every attitude, every motive, every intention I have, he knows. A little scary. What if this was a probe and it was connected to the screen and the surround sound system? And if I put it in your ear, every thought you've had for the past week, we could all see up there. Living color, surround sound. I did this in class one day at the university. And there was a young lady sitting in the second row, and I went over like this, and she screamed. I said, so what have you been thinking about? How about if since the service began, any volunteers? How about right now? And somebody says, man, am I bored? Yeah, that's what it's saying. Every thought, every intention, every motive you have, he is alive and he's active. And like a laser, he understands and he judges. They don't think of judges in a condemning way. He discerns. The better word is discerns. He interacts with. He helps us with the bad ones. He encourages the good ones. He is alive and he's active. He's working with you like a partner, like a counselor who's always there. And nothing is hidden from his sight. Everything is open and laid bare to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So you say, well, what's next? Does that mean I should run and hide? Should I live under my bed? Well, he gives us an invitation. The next word is therefore. When you're reading your Bible, whenever you see the word therefore, you always ask, what's it there for? Because what he's doing is applying. Here's how you respond to this incredible truth. This, for me, scary truth. I wouldn't want you mucking around in my mind. And don't look so pious. You're just as corrupt as I am. You don't want me mucking around in your mind either. But Jesus is always mucking about in our mind. And you would expect, therefore, you better be careful. You better watch out what you think. You better examine your motives. No. Therefore, listen to these words. Come boldly to the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find help in your time of need. He's saying, for heaven's sake, don't run away. For heaven's sake, for God's sake, run to. Because it's a throne of grace. It's where you find mercy. It's where you find help when you're wrestling and struggling. And the beauty, the Old Testament reference that Jesus referred to in his Sermon on the Mount. said, you know, I'm different than that. You heard long ago that you shall not commit murder. And if you commit murder, you're guilty. You're liable before the court. So the Old Testament law said, here's what you should do and here's what you shouldn't do. And after you do it, the law says you are condemned. And Jesus said, but I say to you, do not be angry with your brother. Long before you think of murder, when you're angry, I know the thoughts and intentions and motives of your heart. I know that you're angry. I know you're upset. Come boldly to my throne of grace and receive mercy to help so that you don't commit murder. You don't think about murder. The ancients were told, you shall not commit adultery. And if you do, the penalty is death. But I say to you, Jesus said, when you're struggling, when you're dealing with lust, come boldly to the throne of grace to receive mercy, to find help in your time of need. Long before you commit the act, let me help you deal with the attitude. Let me help you deal with the struggle, with your greed that leads you to steal or to cheat, with your anger that leads you to gossip and to envy and to jealousy and to all these things that destroy, to break up homes and break up marriages, or even when they don't break them up, they fracture them and people live together in these awful relationships in their home. And they don't know what to do. They don't know where to go for help. They go to a counselor who may say, well, I don't get it. I got a great marriage. Or they may go to somebody, friend, who says, well, I get it, but, you know, I don't know how to help. I can't even help myself. I don't have the power to help you. Jesus said, I understand, and I can help. And I'm alive, and I'm active. And like a laser, I understand your lust and your hatred more than you do. And even though you can do nothing about it, and your parents can do nothing about it, and your friends can do nothing about it, and your counselor can do nothing about it, and your pastor can do nothing about it, and you can't do anything about it, I can. So come. Come. You may have to give up a little dignity. You may have to give up a little pride to come and confess, Lord, I'm helpless. I need you. Jesus said, I knew you would. I knew you would. That's why I went to the cross. To pay for your failures. And that's why death could not keep me, because I knew you would need a high priest who understands. The writer of Hebrews says he was tested in every point as we are, yet without sin. It means every temptation, every test, every lustful thought, every greedy thought, every hateful thought you've ever had, Jesus had. I'm uncomfortable with that. I'm uncomfortable with that. I know just how ugly some of my thoughts are. Just how wretched some of my temptations are. And to think that my blessed Lord Jesus wrestled with those same things, but in his humanity, that's what it says, he struggled in every way as we, yet without sin. The difference between Jesus and me is not that I want to do things I shouldn't and he didn't want to do things he shouldn't. The difference is I sometimes do things I shouldn't and he never did. How old were you when you discovered the magic way to get rid of a temptation? Do you know the magic way to get rid of a temptation? Give in. Just do it. I'm on a diet right now, trying to get my girlish figure back. Let's say I'm watching TV and the commercials come on with the food, and I know there's an eclair in the refrigerator. And I keep thinking, man, I'd sure like to eat that eclair. I can just taste it. Man, I really want it. But no, I'm not going to do it. I'm good. Get back into the TV movie. And another food commercial comes on. And the eclair comes up again. You know how to stop my mind going back to that eclair? Go eat it. Jesus never ate the eclair. But he understands the struggle because he wanted the eclair. That may be hard for you to digest. It was hard for me to digest. But what would be the point of saying you have a great high priest, but the problem is he doesn't get it. He's never struggled. The writer of Hebrews says he was made perfect through the things which he suffered. And that doesn't just mean that suffering there. It means the suffering of his life as a human being, wrestling with the same things you and I wrestle with, but wrestling them all the way to the end because he never gave in. Therefore, come boldly to the throne of grace. Phil Yancey, in his book, Rumors, I told you I forget things, wrote this: while I was researching a book on Jesus, I could not help noticing the tenderness with which Jesus treated people with wounds and moral failures. A Samaritan woman with five failed marriages, a tax collector, dishonest tax, an adulteress, a prostitute, a disciple who denied him. All of these received from Jesus not the judgment they expected, but forgiveness and reinstatement. When Jesus was talking with a Samaritan woman, he said, let's just talk. I know you despise me because I'm a Jew, but can we talk? And she ended up bringing the whole village out to meet him. Philip challenged him and said, show us the Father. And Jesus said, have I not been so long with you, Philip, in this relationship? The woman discovered in an adulterous relationship was condemned by the Pharisees. Jesus drove them away and said, neither do I condemn you. To Peter, who denied him three times in his greatest hour of need, he had one question. Peter, do you love me? To Thomas, who doubted him, he said, Thomas, just reach out your hand. Just touch me. Jesus' answer to everyone who failed was the same. I do not condemn you. I'm not going to explain to you how you can pay back for your sin. There is no way to pay back. I will pay for it. When we come to religion, many of us, even when we come to Christianity, we look for rules and creeds and doctrines and laws and regulations and rituals. Jesus said, all I offer you is a relationship. Not about rules and laws and regulations. It's about a loving relationship. It's not about condemnation and the bony finger of guilt. It's about acceptance. Come boldly to the throne of grace to receive mercy and find help no matter what your need. Because I am alive, and I am active, and I love you, and I want to help you. That, my friends, is Christianity in shoe leather. To help his disciples understand, that what he wanted with them was a relationship and not another set of rules. The night he was betrayed, he was having dinner with his friends, his disciples. And after dinner, he said to them, after he picked up the bread and broke it, he said, "This is my body. This bread represents my body, which is broken for you. Whenever you eat it, do so in remembrance of me. Don't ever forget how much I love you." Then he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Whenever you drink it, would you remember? Would you think of me? Would you remember how much I love you? And how much it means to me that you love me?" That's what this is all about, friends. It's a body that was broken for you and blood that was shed so that he could have a relationship with you. And he invites you to participate in that relationship. Now, we can't hand out the elements because of COVID, but you received one of these little things. If you peel off the top, there's a wafer for the bread, and then you peel off the next layer and there's the cup. So take a moment, meditate on what this means, and participate with our Lord Jesus in the breaking of the bread.
Lots of colors this morning, huh? Bells, strings. We got more in store for you. Will you stand and join us in the last hymn, singing quietly? One of my favorite hymns, one of the most beautiful hymns, Lift High the Cross.
Remember to exit from the outside aisles. And thank you for being here and celebrating together the risen Christ. Through this week, remember his invitation. Come boldly to the throne of grace to receive mercy and find grace to help in your time of need. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. Happy Easter. And you are dismissed.